Ladies and gentlemen, Mark Badmoody Joseph and Daniel Bernard Romain.
APAP memories, flow in and out of identities, from performances to volunteer board presidencies, from agents to directors of engagement residencies, all in service of provocation and empathy, all in service of landscapes where people collectively escape, a collective experience in service of the aesthetic and the civic. Our flow is the generation of a connection between the world and its queerly fashioned beauty, this house of cards. Stacked like mirrors, we make intimate space for social mirrors. Our flow is a touch of ego, some splashes of bravado, and a whole lot of hours unseen. Flow from rehearsal studio to the kids at home, to ushers, to budgets, to some airport covered in snow. The performing arts is a cold game. And performing artists got a real task. Speak a creative truth when the truth is so creatively abused in unprecedented ways by this country's unprecedented head of state. Artistic flow holds the high road of our country's current moral debates. Can we agree that the shows are the mode, but the culture is our product? APAP, what kind of culture do we want to make? Of the wrong class, of the wrong caste. placed on the lower track at 6 years young, ain't recovered since. We ask the blackbird why she does not fly while the law walking off with her wings. So savage these, for whom America's a beautiful. Spacious skies merely mock the blackbird with rippled wing. We slice the blackbird's throat, ask her why she doesn't sing. No one remembers there was no head start, no exposure on of the wrong class, of the wrong cast. Placed on the lower track at 6 years young, we ask the blackbird why she does not fly while the law walking off with her wings. So savage these, only see equality in 63 black and white dreams. Is it so savage to dream at last free in technicolor prism, tinged in the right to be? Is it so savage to dream at last free? Dream at last free. Dream at last free. At last free. Free at last. Free at last. Free at last!
Maybe your meeting won't flow like that.
Flow is subjectively practiced. You'll be in your meeting and you'll kind of flow in and out of any kind of memories. Flow in and out of identities, not as scorn of your responsibilities, but rather recommit to who you're responsible to. At its best, APAP reminds you you're not alone. Remember, everyone around you is responsible to proposition and self-critique, the courage to sing and the humility to sing praises, all in service of the performing arts and the culture that it suggests at the edge of these climactic days.
Ladies and gentlemen, your APAP NYC 2017 conference co-chairs, Simone Eccleston, Liz Lerman, and Kevin Spencer.
Good evening. A huge welcome to friends, colleagues, collaborators in the room, those who are watching us online, to the opening session of the 60th Annual Conference of the Association of Performing Arts Presenters. And what about those artists? Nice round of applause for Mark Joseph and Daniel Bernard Romain. That was incredible. Such a powerful and meaningful and inspiring way to launch our time together here. We are again making a number of this year's conference sessions accessible over the internet, courtesy of Culture Hub and HowlRound live streaming service. So please be sure to invite your friends, your colleagues, your family members to view many of our online offerings and streaming events, both live and those that are archived on APAP's website. Simone, Liz, and I have had the privilege of working for almost a year with an amazing conference committee to bring you 5 days of broad, diverse, and inspiring speakers and discussion opportunities. This has been a deeply meaningful experience for me as an artist, or magical experience for me as an artist. To serve in the role of conference co-chair over the past year, and to play a role in developing this year's conference theme of flow. The concept of flow has been quite relevant to my career as a magician, aimed at creating a wave of sensations and focused awareness that leads to a transformative experience. And with my current work, I find this to be a powerful phenomenon, a process for bringing people in the margins of society, for whatever reason, bringing them into the mainstream of the community in which they live. Our hope is that each of you, over the next few days, will find many transformative moments, and that you'll achieve a sense of belonging as vital contributors to the flow of what we do collectively in the APAP community to enrich the lives through the performing arts. Simone?
Indeed, Kevin. In the room this evening, we have artists, presenters, agents and managers, producers, funders, and other colleagues who make it possible for work to be presented to a wide range of audiences and communities across the country and around the world. And certainly, over this past year, we have been reminded that there is a need for the power of artistic expression to cut through ignorance, bigotry, and misperceptions that threaten our humanity. Borrowing from last year's theme, Makers, our role as makers of culture to cultivate, support, and promote the value of the arts in communities struggling with issues and conditions that undermine safety and well-being is now more important than ever. It is a creative challenge to design programming for an event like APAP NYC that attracts and will be of value to close to 4,000 people. And the three of us are thrilled to be working with colleagues you see listed on the screen as part of the Conference Committee. Let's give them a round of applause. A primary goal of the Conference Committee is to make certain that today and over the next 4 days, there are opportunities to share information and ideas that you can apply directly to your work. As we move through the marketplace, experience the wealth of artistry and talent in our fields, and exchange information and ideas in professional development sessions, we ask you to consider these questions. Who in your community doesn't have a sense of belonging within your organization? And how can you use the tools, resources, and artists presented at the APAP NYC Conference to transform that reality? As we work from our organizations and move out into our communities and the world, this will make for a stronger field and hopefully a renewed and more expansive sense of community, as we truly are our brothers and sisters keepers. Also, please make time to reach out and meet new colleagues, especially those who are joining us for the first time and from other countries. These 5 days can at times be overwhelming, even for those of us who have attended many for many years. Please reach out to help each other and sustain that sense of flow over the time we have together. Our co-chair, Liz Lerman, renewed her state of flow in 2016 by relocating to take a position with the Herbert Institute for Art and Design at Arizona State University.
Hi, everybody. Thank you. It's so great to be with the co-chairs, and I just want you to know I'm on a teleprompter now, which means I think if I do well enough, I get to be the next president. Thanks, Simone. And with my move to Arizona has come the opportunity to meet and work with an extraordinary number of deeply talented artists and creative thinkers from around the country, many of whom are here, including Dan Romain, who you just got to hear. I'd also like to emphasize how events over the past year, and especially in recent months, have made all of us aware of the need to engage with our communities and our governments in acknowledging and perhaps bridging the growing chasms in our country. I think it's so good that we're together at this moment to help each other think personally and communally about the work ahead. As a committee, our discussions led to the concept of flow, initially proposed by the positive psychologist, Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. I went to YouTube to find out how to say that. he suggests a total immersion in an activity where your state of mind is completely focused on what is doable, that somehow then the usual obstacles will fall away. Although these amazing phone calls with 30 people on them led to many disputes about the singular definition, there was a unanimous interest in the metaphorical possibilities of this idea. So we explored a lot of other ways in which the concept relates to the arts and what we do in the presenting field. And from that process, some sub-themes
for the conference surfaced. How does the creative mind figure in finding flow? How do we find flow together as collaborators and partners? How does innovation and disruption, which is one of some of the core processes of the creative act, how do they contribute to flow? And how might we harness creative flow to achieve the social change, not only that we need, but that we demand? These are questions that will be addressed by speakers and in conversations with you throughout this year's professional development program. There are so many wonderful examples of individual organizations and partners who are working to achieve this kind of flow, work that cultivates change, repairs damage, and brings people together in imagining a different future. This includes putting forward images and experiences in art that embolden and aid in fighting these challenges and setbacks. And of course, we just saw that, heard that, and felt that. In addition to reserving some of the professional development program time, we know that you're going to want to take advantage of all the incredible experiences of live performances ahead of you. Plan for your future programming, deepening your sense of belonging as a valued member of this APAP community. Kevin?
So, I'm here to encourage you. Don't hesitate to introduce yourself to any members of the conference committee, APAP staff, board members. There's also an information desk, which I've visited many times since I've been here, one day, right across from the registration desk. If you need any specific information, if you're feeling a bit lost, overwhelmed, you need a hug, whatever, come by and we'll try to help you out. And finally, all of this goes without saying that this task would be nearly impossible for us if not for the work that APAP does, the year-round work that APAP does and the APAP team does. They've been responsive to our interests, our concerns, and they themselves have entered this conference state of flow in about February of last year. So they hit this thing really, really hard. And they really hit flow over the holidays, much to the chagrin of their families and friends. We want to thank Mario, the staff, and especially the over 100 volunteers who are going to be with us over the next few days. Yes. Some of whom are at the information desk and know me well. So, here to share some of the highlights of what you can expect in the days ahead, it is my pleasure to introduce the man who is in the ultimate flow mode right now, APAP's Vice President of Programs and Resources, my friend Scott Stoner.
Hey, y'all. Welcome, welcome. It's great to see you all, and on behalf of the APAP team, I want to say it's truly a pleasure working with this conference committee and the co-chair triumvirate you've just met. They are true givers. Each gave to us a measurable level of thought, candor, inspiration, and that's what we needed to guide the conference programming this year. So, are you ready to go with the flow? Please take a deep breath, put down your reading materials, buckle up your seats, and listen to the following guidelines. First of all, flow tips. First, this is not a fashion show, unless you're on stage and wearing a tie. But you need to dress for the temperature changes from room to room, from venue to venue. I found out it's 99 steps from the Sheraton to the Hilton. I do it every day. For me, it's a minute. If it's under 30 degrees, it's a little faster. But do that. Take time to eat, drink, and sleep. There's only so many hours in the day and the night, but physical substance is necessary. Urban Kitchen aims to please. It's open. Ask for help. We do have over 100 volunteers, 20 staff, 24 board members, and they've all got ribbons on their badges, or a green shirt. Or otherwise, just go to the information desk. And finally, make a daily plan to use your app, or for the technology challenged, the program guide. There's over 100, 360 exhibit booths 1,000-plus showcase performances, and close to 80 professional development sessions. So I'm sorry if you missed this morning's forums and this afternoon's up next pitch session and the new colleagues orientation, but in a short while, we're gonna bring onto this stage a group of firebrand artists to share their perspectives on current affairs nationally and globally, and how we as a field can play a key role in affecting social change and resilience that will be needed in this new year ahead. Saturday Flow, tomorrow at 9 a.m., promises to be a really provocative discussion about creativity, innovation, disruption, and their importance in bringing about change that leads to success. And then you're going to want to discover how a very talented group of artists find their flow in our popular Saturday Bishakasha format. Again, this year moderated by our good friend Liz Lerman. And the expo hall is also open tomorrow. It opens at 2 o'clock, from 2 to 6:30. Plus we have professional development sessions available between 2 and 5. On Sunday, join your colleagues in, for consortium meetings and professional development sessions and the 11 a.m. plenary session that is gonna focus on collaboration, creative collaboration, the how creative teams find their flow together. And don't miss a cameo appearance by a special guest from New York's artist community at the beginning of the session. In addition to the expo hall on Sunday afternoon, we hope you will consider also attending the Sino-American seminar, which is about booking and touring artists from China. That's from 2 to 5 over at the Sheraton. That brings us to Monday, and our annual 5 Minutes to Shine takes place on Monday morning, followed by the APAP member meeting, where we will expect to announce a new name for the organization. The annual APAP Awards Luncheon begins promptly at noon, and we are so pleased that Ben Vereen is going to serve as our Master of Ceremonies. The event includes the winner of our 5 Minutes to Shine competition, and of course the Award of Merit presentation to Laurie Anderson. Monday, also, we're so pleased to be celebrating this year the 20th anniversary of YPCA, the Young Professionals Career Advance Program for Young Classical Musicians. So please honor this program and this year's award recipients by attending the YPCA showcase and reception at Carnegie Hall on Monday from 6 to 8 p.m. The showcase flow, of course, they're gonna be happening. Again, over 1,000 showcase performances here in the hotel and around the city, and we know you're gonna be spending your evenings and parts of some days experiencing the work of an extraordinary range of artists who hope to perform in your community. They're available here in hotels, I said, across the city, and they're all listed on your app or in the printed program guide. That will bring us, if you're still alive, that will bring us to the flow finale. Finally, on Tuesday morning in the Trianon Ballroom, we top off our main flow of events with what will surely be memorable time spent with who I think is today's Renaissance ideal, Taylor Mack. So, APAP is the place to be, the center of our biz, the place where it happens. Find your flow, integrate expo, meet Mojo. It's the place where it happens. Creative flow, showcases galore, yours to explore. In this place where it happens, open your mind through open exchange, bring about change. This is the place. This is the place where it happens. That's all I got. And now please welcome our flow master himself, Mr. Mario Garcia Durham.
There once was a gentleman from La Pop who came to a conference called APAP. That's the best I can do, sorry. Thank you, Scott. Scott's our poet. Anyway, welcome. I have never been happier to see all of you and welcome all of you to this conference. It's been a challenging year in many ways. It's been a good year in many ways, but I'm really, really happy to be here with you all. I wanna congratulate Scott and everyone who contributed to this terrific program and the conference committee and all they have created. We all appreciate these generous and dedicated members who, together with our hardworking staff, make this annual convening possible. There's another special group of individuals whose support is critically important. Please join me in expressing our sincere gratitude to the many sponsors who provide critical resources we need to make an event of this size so successful. So please join me in thanking our sponsors after I read them off. Hold that excitement. So first, I'd like to thank generous programming from our colleagues in the government and the foundation world. These include the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation and the Doris Duke Foundation for Islamic Arts, the American Express Foundation, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, and the Wallace Foundation. We also receive generous annual conference support from the National Endowment for the Arts. I would also like to thank our goal-level sponsors, IMG Artist, Kepler Speakers, and Opus 3 Artist. Our silver-level sponsors are Alan Harris Productions, David Belenzon Management, Canada Council for the Arts, ICM Partners, KMP, and CAMI. And our bronze level sponsors, Scenarium, Don Elder Management, Instant Encore, the City of New York Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, the Music Managers Forum, Pomegranate Arts, Do You Speak Djembe, Starbucks Booking, Umbel, and WJ3 Records. And we also want to thank Culture Hub, Gig Salad, Cosson Talent, and Sage Artist. Now, we all know how important sponsors are, so please give them a rousing amount of applause. Thank you. And if you see any of those individuals, please thank them on my behalf. Well, I'm heartened to be here today to welcome and thank you all for making this annual pilgrimage to APAP. I would like to introduce someone else who represents a large team of dedicated staff and who also appreciate the annual gathering of the APAP community and are here to serve you. I'm pleased to introduce you to the general manager of the New York Hilton, Mr. Lawrence Zierin. Please welcome him. Lawrence?
Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity just to welcome you to the New York Hilton. It's an interesting setup. I can't see anybody in the room. That's pretty cool. I'm obviously not one of those performers, right? I'm not used to it. Normally not on stage, at least. Just wanted to welcome you. We've had a 48 years of partnership with APAP, which is extremely special. We've been partners for a long time in this. It's extremely great to have you with us again. As your opening performance said earlier on, I think the theme of the opening performance was kind of, you're not alone here, you're not alone in this. Luckily enough, I'm not alone in this as well. There's 1,300 team members that are here to serve and to be ready to just be great partners over the next couple of days. So again, just want to say thank you very much. I just understood that there is free hugs at the information desks. So if you're looking for me, that's where I'll be. Thanks.
Thank you. You know, there's another group here that I would really like to welcome because I was one of them at one point. These are the newcomers who are first timers. So newcomers, first timers, would you please stand? Thank you. This year we joyously celebrate our 60th anniversary of APAP's birth. This was made possible by a small group of concert hall managers who came together in Madison, Wisconsin. They were all distinct individuals, but what brought them together was a shared sense of vision, purpose, and values. I am deeply touched to be here 60 years later with so many amazing, committed, and courageous individuals whom I consider to be part of our APAP extended family. I value our strong spirit of belonging, of being a member of this body of professionals who have dedicated their lives to making a difference in the communities they serve. I value the power of the freedom of expression and breaking creative boundaries. I value our respect and acceptance of difference. In these times of great uncertainty, I take comfort in the fact that we as a field will and must continue to fight even stronger for those who would otherwise be denigrated or marginalized. It is the common values we share to make life better for all by enabling authentic and sustained access to the creative arts that make me so proud to be a part of this organization. And now, I have the pleasure of introducing a distinguished playwright, novelist, and screenwriter who will frame this evening's focus on the arts, community engagement, and social change. Ayad Akhtar is probably best known among many of you as the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of the play Disgraced, which ran on Broadway and was nominated for a Tony Award in the 2015 season. His novel, American Dervish, has been published in 20 languages, and his plays, The Who and the What and The Invisible Hand, are also currently in production around the world. The son of Pakistani immigrants and growing up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, we expect Mr. Akhtar has an authentic perspective on Muslim American identity. But I should note, when asked about that in a New York Times interview, he simply said, "I am trying to tell the best story I possibly can." We look forward to hearing more from this prodigious American writer this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Ayad Akhtar.
Good evening. Good to be with you. I'm going to read these remarks in pieces of paper rather than teleprompter. I want to thank the Planning Committee for the invitation to address you all. When I was first approached about offering these introductory remarks, I inquired about the committee's hope for what I might say. Something uplifting, they responded. Something about art's potential to change the world. Right. I wasn't sure, I told them, that I could really do that. I toyed with offering my apologies, politely declining. I couldn't see how to be uplifting and at the same time force the conversation I thought needed to be had. I said as such. They responded, "By all means, speak your mind." I thought, okay. Chinese have an interesting proverb that I'd like to start with, and I quote, "In a house where the son kills the father, the causes do not lie between the morning and the evening of a single day." The political events of the last few months in this country are not the result of a single day's election tally, nor of a season of campaigning that brought to those who paid sustained attention to it more nausea than anything else. No. The recent political events are the quaking eruption of a tectonic shift that has been at least two generations in the making, a shift that long ago infected our nation's soil. The logic of the market, the rules of the market's language and being, value reduced to its exclusively monetary meaning. Competition, not as a striving toward betterment, a striving for, as the Latin etymology of the word suggests, but a struggle to wean out the weak, deify the strong, and offer up the lowest price. Our language and experience have become polluted by the ethos of finance. We seek upside and minimize our exposure. We consider the best use of our sweat equity. We invest in relationships. We communicate our deal breakers and negotiate around our competing interests. Indeed, even our greatest human intimacies are increasingly nothing more than transactions. We have become customers to reality. The market has reached so far into us. It has replaced our old deities with a new one, the religion of commerce, ruled not by Yahweh or Krishna, but by another disembodied abstraction hovering far beyond us, whose well-being we tend to with unflagging collective attention, the economy. We are terrified of its humors, grateful for its dispensations. We are exhorted to appease and placate the economy with our ritual purchases. For indeed, the spending of money has become our daily act of penitence and absolution and rapture par excellence. When our economy is well, we are a happy people. And when it isn't, premonitions of ultimate doom are never far. How did this happen? How did the logic of finance, its devouring and monetizing imperative, make money everywhere and in any way? How did this aberration, this deformation, come to stake its dubious claim on every part of every one of our lives? This is the real question, not what art can do about it. For what can art do about it? The logic of finance has only delegitimized what art does best, which is to nurture and develop the most invisible, interior, intangible parts of us. What use is the soul's growth if it doesn't make you money? Indeed, what use even to speak of a soul in the near totalitarian era of the market? We are customers, first and foremost. Of course the humanities are useless to us. To wit, little surprise that we are gutting music education on every level. Long ago, we ceased being a culture capable of truly knowing that responsiveness to the world is fundamentally rhythmic, that attunement to cadence and phrase, the embodiment of beauty in song, that these are fundamental human capacities requiring development, and that their development is something more central to us than the periodic table. It's an education in being. Wishful thinking, warm, well-meaning expressions of weakness in the face of reality's cold truth, which apparently only money makes apparent. And so, an education in music or philosophy or literature or performance, and that list goes on, is of no fundamental use to us in this era of the economy, for these do not help one secure existing wealth or accumulate future wealth. These are the only terms of the good in our world today. Wealth is our only genuine societal covenant. Art's great capacity is to renew and restore, to remind us of death, to cleanse and nourish us, to offer us a path to a clearer, more vivid sense of ourselves and each other. But art in the service of commerce cannot do any of this, not really. Indeed, art in the service of commerce isn't really called art anymore. It's called content. Content to be distributed across platforms, enabling the swift and frictionless monetization of the viewer's attention. Art becomes content, which becomes branded entertainment, which becomes advertising. How far we have fallen. Percy Shelley, the great English romantic writer, believed that poets and philosophers were what he called the, quote, unacknowledged legislators of mankind. Really? Maybe not so crazy after all if you take your definition of poetry and philosophy and lower it, as we seem to do with everything these days. After all, who is most effective at influencing and transforming the way people speak and behave today? How they think, what they believe to be worth pursuing, worth being. Indeed, which storytellers, if you will, are most deeply shaping the imaginal landscape of our time? Those who have been most effective at turning their content to commerce's use. Those best at selling themselves. Those best at art as advertising. The Kardashians and Jenners, the Jay-Z's, and of course, yes, the Trumps of the world. Unacknowledged legislators, indeed. Of course, most of us in this room do not believe we can compete in that way, and we don't necessarily want to. We're outliers, suffering the prevailing cultural sickness, endeavoring, often at great cost to ourselves, to toe a different line. And we know that peculiar and common discouragement of trying to articulate the good we are attempting, with it never quite landing on our listeners. That, mind you, is part of the problem, for when we are transformed from citizens first into customers and consumers foremost, well, then different rules apply. When I'm the customer, I know what I want, and I pay for it, and you give it to me. That's the social contract. But art's different. It's not about giving a customer what they already know they want, just at a better price. Art, at its essence, is always about the unknown, and at its best is not something given at all, but shared. Art, at its truest, has never had an easy place in the economy of commerce. We here in this room may indeed be towing a different line, but make no mistake, we have not resisted the corrosive effects of this rampant unconscious materialism in our world today. Needing to bridge the divide with those who do not understand, with a culture that will not understand, we change the way we talk. Now we embrace the terms of tangible good, social justice, advocacy, changing minds, opening perspectives, empathy. We objectify and quantify art's good. We find our fight. We make our case and articulate the narrative. We turn ourselves into salespeople for our causes. And with time, we grow hidebound. Hidebound by our battles, beholden to our identities, committed to promoting and celebrating our differences. But let me submit, at its best, art has always been about unity, not difference. And that in this age of art denatured by commerce, in an age in which, at its best, art appears to be a tool for advocacy, art loses its deepest and truest meaning. Any vision of art as a vision of advertising by another name is just that, a commercial. Such is the world we have allowed to come into being. We have allowed that world, each of us. If there is any hope for the future of our human experience, as opposed to our mediated, monetized experience, we would do well, I suspect, I hope, I submit, spending more time pondering that matter than struggling to make our case for art as a vehicle of change. Thank you.
Yes. Ayad, please come back. Thank you, Ayad. We just a reminder, we have these plenary recordings. These plenary sessions recorded, so you can share that with friends. So thank you. We can scroll up a little, please. And now I have a, see the magic. I have the unique opportunity to hear from five individuals who are also making a difference in the face of derisiveness and disruption by engaging audiences in thoughtful and meaningful ways. We know that conversations like this are most effective when there is a dynamic and insightful moderator. So we naturally turn to a past APAP NYC keynote speaker who, in the midst of the devastating economy setback this country faced 6 years ago, introduced us to the concept of resilience and how we might apply to it organizational capacity and strategies for a strong, sustainable future. And for those of you that were here for the keynote of the following individual, it was an amazing, almost life-changing keynote. So I am, of course, referring to Robin Archer. Yes, you can applaud. She is, and those who haven't heard her, I promise you, she's amazing. A native Australian who holds an honorary doctoral degree from multiple universities and citations of merit from multiple countries. Robin is a singer, writer, artistic director, and public advocate for the arts. She is currently the chair of the Gold Coast Cultural Precinct, artistic director of Light and Winter in Melbourne, and chair of the National Institute of Dramatic Arts inaugural Master of Fine Arts. Named Cabaret Icon at the 2016 Adelaide Cabaret Festival, she continues to perform recitals throughout the world. So, as Scott has written for me here, so you think your schedule is overwhelming? It is nothing. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our moderator for this conversation, Robin Archer.
Thanks very much, Mario. And because we're so used to doing this in my country these days, I will do it here to acknowledge the original inhabitants of this land we meet on and pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging, and extend that respect to any other First Nations people who are here today. Our topic for this opening plenary invites us to consider how we as artists and programmers, managers, producers, agents can use our skills to serve as catalysts for the kind of engagement which can lead to social change. Ayad has already thrown out a special provocation
And I'll follow with another. It is from Amir Reza Kuestani, a beautiful Iranian playwright who still cannot get a visa to the United States. At an event a couple of years ago in Amsterdam, he said, "People say to me, it must be so difficult for you to do the work you do in your own country." And he says, "No," I reply to them, "I do my work. I write my plays, I present them, I get shut down two or three times a year, and if I wasn't getting shut down, I'd know that I'm not doing my job properly." This was the cut. Then came the thrust. He said, "You in the West talk so much about your freedoms of speech, etc. I think that you have so much freedom because nobody listens to what you say. You present no threat. You represent no danger." So is this true? Are we toothless in the face of current crises? As a singer, my area of specialty is the repertoire of Germany in the 1920s and 30s, a time following the New York Stock Exchange crash of 28-29, when the German currency was rendered absolutely valueless. There was deep despair, high unemployment, and a feeling of disenfranchisement. One powerful orator gained political power by saying, "I will make Germany great again." I know who to blame. He gave despairing communities false hope through easy answers. But we know that life is not like that, that there are no easy answers, and that it's the arts that most effectively explore the ambiguities, the complexities, the nuances of the grey areas between black and white, right and wrong, win and lose. And for me, singing the complex political songs of that era is in itself a political act. One of Bertolt Brecht's poems from that era goes, "My young son asks, in the bad times, will there still be singing? Yes, there will still be singing about the bad times." But is that any longer enough, only to articulate the crisis? Are we obliged also to be activists? And to discuss this today, we have one of the most fantastic panels I have ever been given the privilege to moderate. Bree Newsom is a graduate of NYU's Tisch School of the Arts and an award-winning, yes, go ahead. An award-winning filmmaker, writer, composer, singer, community activist, and organizer. She says that these are not separate endeavors. Art is activism and activism is art, as she seamlessly blends her talents in pursuit of social and economic justice. Bree currently works as a Western field organizer for Ignite NC, a project of the Southern Vision Alliance, and as a founding member of Tribe, a grassroots organizing collective dedicated to empowering underserved communities in Charlotte, North Carolina. Please welcome Bree Newsom. And now a first. I have long been trying to make the connection between art and sport. And a first for this conference, we are about to meet an Olympic medalist. Ibtihaj Muhammad is a member of the United States fencing team and five-time senior world medalist, including this summer's event in Rio de Janeiro. A graduate of Duke University with a dual major in international relations and African studies and a minor in Arabic, Ms. Muhammad currently serves on the US Department of State's Empowering Women and Girls Through Sport initiative. Named in Time magazine's list of 100 most influential global voices, please welcome to our stage Ibtihaj Muhammad. We're also delighted to have with us this evening from Los Angeles, Martha Gonzalez, a singer, songwriter, and percussionist for the Grammy Award-winning band Quetzal. She has collaborated and toured with an amazing array of artists. Ms. Gonzalez is also a feminist music theorist and assistant professor in the Intercollegiate Department of Chicana, Chicano, Latina, Latina Studies at Scripps Claremont College. She describes herself as a Chicana artivista, an artist and activist, and this has included catalyzing the transnational dialogue between the Chicanos, Latino communities in the US and Jarocho communities in Veracruz, Mexico. A recent blog described Martha as the writer of songs that inspired, as well as serving as a way to check oneself. Please welcome Martha Gonzalez. This is really a panel to wrangle, huh? This is good. So please welcome back for our conversation our absolutely remarkable opening speaker, Ayed Akhtar. Hey, thank you. So I think that we should start thinking about this idea of artist activist. Ayed, throw out a marvelous provocation about the way that we have possibly been guilty of entering into this economic era and not looking after the core things that we are supposed to be about. An artist is essentially about their art, but I know that there are people on this panel who think that it is much more than just that. And Bree, I'd like to start with you. Let's have your comments on this.
Well, certainly. I think that, you know, it could be argued that not every artist is an activist. I don't know that every artist makes activism or a cause necessarily, or even a political cause, the central focus of their art. I would argue that there's no such thing as apolitical art, but that's maybe another, another point. But I do think that it's undeniable that artists have always played an essential role in social change. If you look especially at any point in history where you have an oppressive power rise to the forefront, it's not surprising that artists tend to be one of the first groups that get targeted simply because of the power of art to move and to change people. And we have so many examples too of social movement, obviously a very powerful thing in and of itself, but very much reliant and dependent on art to communicate. If you look at the civil rights movement of the 60s, I mean, you cannot tell that story without the protest songs. One other example that comes to my mind often when I think about the power of film is the struggle for AIDS awareness and AIDS activism. And I mean, it's true that the film Philadelphia had a tremendous impact in really bringing the awareness and understanding of the struggle for AIDS rights and activism to the forefront of the public consciousness. So it just really cannot be understated. And I know that there was a period of time where I was just, you know, solely focused on you know, pursuing film and music. And I was always politically conscious, you had a political consciousness, but I have really come to a deeper understanding that there really is no separation in my mind between my art and my activism. As I said, I don't think that there is such a thing as political art. Even in a decision as simple to write a role for a black female character, like you have to understand why that in and of itself is a political act.
Do you also think that, I mean, my impression is that artists who act for change are called political artists, but those who don't act for change are not called political artists, and yet surely they are. As you were saying, everything is a political act. Ayed, your take on that?
I mean, I just spoke for 10 minutes about
that. Exactly. Yeah.
So maybe I'm eager to hear what some of the other folks think.
Good.
Is that okay?
So
come back to me.
Yeah, I'll come back to you. Very good. Martha, you're clearly involved in processes of activism using art. Where does your balance sit in this?
Well, you know, I consider myself an artivista. And yes, it is marking a brand, but not necessarily a brand. By calling myself a Chicana artivista, I don't necessarily want to brand myself as much as I want to focus on the kind of work that I do. I'm an artist who, singer, songwriter, and percussionist who has instilled a lot of time and energy in my group, Quetzal. And our work is really reflective of our community, right? We write about Chicano identity, feminism, about our community, ways of empowering our community. But then we've also been really involved in creating process-based work, right? Where we're not coming up with products, but mainly using our skills as artists to engage communities in these processes. Collective songwriting method, which we've utilized throughout the country, in prisons, detention centers, but then also to make policy legible for communities that are affected by funding, or Proposition 47, for example, in California. So that's been really important to us. Fandango movement, for example, is also using our skills to engage community and participating in the music and art making for the sake of participating and building community to instigate a kind of dialogue. So I think that, you know, I feel like I fluctuate through both worlds, you know. I feel like this body shifts through all of these different spaces. I write about this stuff as an academic, you know. I write about the process. I write about myself as an artist on the stage, as well as an artist in the trenches of community. So for me, you know, I agree with you. Art is, it's always political. It's always rooted in the body, right? If you're a white male creating art, you know, they create art oftentimes, and we create political art because I'm small Mexican and, you know, fiery or whatever, right? So it's like, you know, that in itself, the fact that we're able to make these kinds of distinctions and not name whiteness for what it is, I think that's it's really important that we, that also has race and it has power and it has, there's a place in society that's really centralized and we are othered. And that's really dangerous, I think, to look at. And we really need to look at everything that's out there as rooted in a place and a body and a privilege, you know, or not.
Ibtihaj, just your very act of taking up a sport like this makes you a presence which is undeniable. Your messaging, even when you are simply practicing as an elite sports person, that's what you have to do. Your practice is intense as, I guess, elite artists in some ways. There are similarities. But the very fact that you are there doing what you're doing must surely be interpreted in many quarters as a statement. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that?
You know, when I chose to even participate in the sport of fencing, I felt like I, you know, from the very beginning at the age of, you know, the tender age of 12 was kind of challenging the norm. Not just within the sports arena, participating in a sport that was predominantly white, but also from the cultural perspective. As, you know, a girl and coming from, you know, a Muslim family, it not being very common for, you know, I guess my parents to even push their girls into sports. So pursuing sport as a career path was from the very beginning, you know, just kind of out of our cultural box. It was out of the norm. And I guess my involvement in sport as a Muslim woman who does wear the hijab, it's always felt like activism for me, because I was, from a very young age, again, always seen as different within my sport itself. But I think that just my, like you said, my presence in sport, being a woman who wears the hijab, kind of challenges the narrative that has been set forth for the Muslim community, and kind of flips it on its head, because when we think of Muslim women, we don't think of them, we don't think of Muslim women, in my opinion, in the way in which we really are. We're very diverse. We don't all wear hijab. We're not all Arab. We don't all, you know, live in the Middle East. We're not oppressed. We don't, you know, we have voices. And I feel like just being a woman, an American woman on the U.S. Olympic team, I think just in itself challenges that narrative. And like I said, I don't think that it was by choice to be an activist, but I want to, well, I guess in a sense it is, because I know, especially for the United States team, we're kind of pushed in a sense where it's like, when you get to the Olympics, you can't speak on political situations. And that was always set forth, like that was the precedent. But for me, it's been important to speak not just for, you know, the Muslim community, but also for even, you know, myself as a minority, as a female. I think it's my social responsibility to kind of give back and be a source of change, and I've always felt that way.
I understand that you do a lot of speaking at the moment, a lot of inspiring other people. What are the main needs out there in, for instance, the young Muslim community in America? What do you see as the principal need?
Well, I think it's really important for us to have not just our are boys involved in sport, but also for women. And I know that that is a challenge within the Muslim community to stress the importance of having our girls involved in sport, and not just for all the amazing things that I think can benefit communities and having our girls involved in sport, whether that be from the perspective of them just having strong leadership skills and them just developing into just believing in themselves from a really young age, and also having healthy communities, but also I think that it not only is important for our girls and for our boys, but also just for, I think, our communities as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Do any of you see a fundamental difference between the kind of role models that sport provides and the role models that the arts can inspire? Bree, is there anything, any difference in your mind, or do you see it in the same way?
I see it more in the same way. I mean, and it kind of depends on the type of arts you do, because there's a certain athleticism that can be, I mean, dancers are athletes. I think a lot of times people don't even respect the extent to which dancers really are athletes. So I think there's a certain athleticism in performance. Even, frankly, if you're sitting at the piano playing, if you are, like, seriously a piano player, you can understand there's an athleticism involved in that as well. And so I think that culturally, artists and athletes tend to carry the same kind of significance. I think it's kind of ironic in a way that the Olympics has this rule around artists, because, you know, not making political statements, because the Olympics is one of the most political events that there is, and it always has been, and has historically been the site of major political statements being made, whether it's Jesse Owens running, you know, in Germany, or it's, you know, athletes raising the Black Power fist in 1968, you know. So I think that there's a lot of similarity there. I'm also not surprised that you see a lot of crossover between athletes and artists, you know. And I think in a way, the sport, I mean, when you see her fencing, I mean, that is art to me. I would consider that art as well.
It's certainly a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I also think of, like, I mean, for myself in my sport, I think of Muhammad Ali, right? And all the work that he did, not just inside the boxing ring, but outside the boxing ring as a social activist and wanting to be a proponent of change. So I don't think that I'll ever come close to the work that he did outside of the boxing ring, but that's what I think of in terms of wanting to leave a legacy outside of sport and being a proponent of change.
But I don't think a lot of, I mean, I could be mistaken, but a lot of athletes nowadays, with few exceptions, are really taking on the voice of being, mm-hmm. using their voice as a sense of, you know, to say something political or to object or to, because the funders go away and they make everybody uncomfortable, mm-hmm. and they're like, don't, why are you talking? You should be playing, you know, with the exception of people like Brown, I forget his first name, sorry. My husband would kill me. He's a huge basketball fan, but like, mm-hmm. there are a lot of athletes that are really doing, you know, say that again. LeBron James. James, that's his name, that's right.
Oh, man.
Right? But very few people, I mean, you look back, if you look at classic sports.
You're really not into sports,
I know, right? I know, seriously, jeez, sorry about that. But if you look back at, my husband watches a lot of classic sports, and as we watch, you know, how amazing, what a great, how articulate the athletes were in talking about their sport, their contracts, what they were going through, how they saw their responsibility to communities, to their own communities and beyond. You know, they weren't afraid to do that very much. And I feel like more and more athletes aren't really doing that as much.
But
so
I think,
it's great
yeah.
to hear you say, to speak the way you do and the way you're talking about, you know, how you recognize how what you're challenging with the hijab and, you know, being an openly Muslim woman, you know.
Right, but I mean, I think that you hit the nail on the head when you talk about endorsements and,
yeah.
you know, the financial opportunity or missed opportunity in you know, speaking up and speaking out against, you know, mm-hmm. especially for us now in this political climate. Mm-hmm. I think that people are, afraid that maybe in some
mm-hmm.
way that'll kind of jeopardize their bank account.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure with someone like LeBron James, for him, like, you know, it's probably a drop in the bucket to lose a few million. But for some of...
He probably has lost some things.
Oh, right? No, I'm sure. But, yeah. you know, I think when we think of it from, like, Muhammad Ali's perspective, I know
yeah.
that he had a very, very spiritual perspective on the way that he thought about money and also about... you know, wanting to help others. For him, his reward was never, you know, in this world, but he thought of it from, like, a religious perspective. And I think that there are athletes, not to maybe the magnitude of someone like LeBron James, but I do think that there are athletes who believe that that is, you know, at the forefront of their, you know, that's more important than even their career, is to speak out against injustice.
Mm-hmm. A couple of you said in our earlier conversations that despite the conditions at the moment, you thought that there was still a kind of hopefulness. I'd be very interested to hear what, I'm sure this audience would be very interested to know, what the nature of hope might be at the moment. Martha?
Well, I wasn't in on that conversation. I might not have been. But you know, I go through waves. I think that hope is always present. And I think that if you consider yourself somebody who works on your craft, and yes, as you know, you have to make your living, all that, but if you're also engaged and connected to communities, I think you can't help but have hope. Because you work with communities. I work with communities every day where I'd be like throwing my hands up, you know. But to watch these señoras that we work with in East LA and the kind of how they get up every morning and keep going, you know. I mean, I watch my mom go off to work every day, works, washes women's hair all day long, you know. And I can't complain. I get to express myself. You know, I have, you know, there's so much to do. We can't give up. And art, I think, is intrinsically feeding us as we're expressing ourselves, but it's also sort of, if we're connected to communities, I think it's also, they're generating hope for us as well.
So Bree, you were talking about a kind of hopefulness in the middle of, I hope I don't misrepresent your comments, of escalating hate crime since the election, and how do you see hope in that context?
Yes, absolutely. I think, first of all, it's important to acknowledge that the fear is extremely real, especially for people who are living in the most vulnerable population. So the undocumented members of the Muslim community in my community. I mean, everyone's feeling the threat, but I think it's really important for people to recognize how afraid people are, legitimately afraid, and I think that their fears are justified. That said, I completely agree. I think that a lot of my hope comes from my proximity to the community and being around folks who are doing a lot of the work on a community level. These are people whose names are not in magazines. These are people whose names are not written in history books. But I see them every day making a change, and it lets me know that there are, for every, you know, evil act that is in the world, there are millions of people out here who are really working to make a better world, who are committed to making a better world. And I think that's what gives me hope. I have hope in the people. I've seen, just looking at history, humanity, we have the ability to evolve. And I think art and creativity speaks to our ability to create and shape the world in which we live. We don't, you know, yes, we inherit the world as it is, but we have the power to create and shape it as it goes forward. And I think that art is a continual reminder of that we have the ability to put something in the world that was not there when we got it.
So, Ayad, coming back to you, how do we recalibrate? If there are pockets of hopefulness, if proximity to communities and people who are working hard to make a better world, what's the possibility of recalibrating what artists have been doing to contribute possibly not to a better world, which is what you're inferring? How do we get back again? How do we find the soul again?
Well, of course, I have no idea.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. That's fine. So,
I mean, that's the obvious.
Excellent. Yes.
Obvious, you know, truth. Taking that as a starting off point. What was the question again?
Just if we have gone so far down the path of entering into this economic era and taking on its language and being and that becoming our value system in a way, how do we even begin to start recalibrating?
So again, I'll say I don't know, but let me say this, that. If we think of the great tradition of tragedy and what purpose that served within the sort of collective body of a society, of the society in which it was born, the Greek society, I'm reminded of the Taoists who have this idea that in the moment that you fully, open-heartedly accept the inevitable reality of your own death, in the very next moment is the Tao. The Tao is born from the very next moment. Tragedy has always operated at its best, at its most essential, as a way of confronting us with the reality of death. the reality of our death individually, the reality of death socially. It's only from that kind of confrontation with the finitude, with suffering, the acceptance of those things. And, you know, Cornel West had a really wonderful response in The Guardian to, you know, what could we do now in the era of this, I don't even want to talk about it. We said we could learn to suffer again. Learn to actually suffer for what we believe in, because we have forgotten how to suffer. We're so enamored by the fleeting neo-reptilian pleasures of our devices. And we have lost the capacity, we have lost the capacity cognitively to suffer. And then we want to talk about change? Change what? Just change the screen. Have a new screensaver. That's your change. So it seems to me that the legacy of art, the tradition of art, has within it the resources to empower us, embolden us, to renew us, but it comes at great cost. It's not just talk. And so I don't know, you know, how to respond to it, because I'm just talking.
This evening in Amsterdam, where Amir Reza Kouestani made those comments, was an evening to honor Free Leysen of Belgium, and Peter Sellers, a former awardee of the Erasmus Prize, made the opening comments, and he praised Free for all her work over 30 years and said he was very proud of his work as well. But he said, we have already seen in Europe what the worst excesses of the extreme right can do. We've seen the bestiality that occurs. And if he looked at his work and Free's work over 3-4 decades, he said, I have to admit that as much as we love you, we've actually failed. Mm. And if we don't develop new tools to be able to combat this, then we will fail again and again, and our work will be worth nothing. And when the moderator asked Free Leysen, so what would the new tools be? She hesitated for a moment, and then she said, I just think we've been too polite. Mm-hmm. And I think that's hand in hand with the idea of suffering, that it's also something that Mario mentioned, my talking about resilience quite a bit. And one of the things about resilience is that if you want to remain resilient, there is a certain amount of pain in that. You've actually got to start reducing your footprint, you've got to start reducing the lifestyle. Indeed, the reptilian pleasures may have to decline if you really want things to get better. And so...
Yeah, and less concern about my well-being.
Yeah, I'm going to die anyway.
Yeah.
Face it.
What am I so preoccupied by my well-being? I'm trying to advance my agenda so that I can be well? It's that kind of individualism at the heart of... That's what is polluting the environment. That is the inducement that finance offers.
So you're talking in relation to... I'm sorry.
You're
talking in relation to... as artists, right? Is that what you're saying? Because I can't go into a community and say, you guys have to suffer more. You know, in Boyle Heights, East LA, like you guys have to. But so tell me who is to suffer more? How should we approach communities? Because I think it's really important that we, with the kinds of skills that we have, that we've developed, that we've studied, whether you studied it or learned it by oral tradition or whatever, that we go into communities. Yes, we do. We try to make a living and the paid work, and we're here, you know, and we try to do all of those things, but that we're also really cognizant of engaging and disrupting the market by doing more process-based work. You know, we need to engage more process-based work where there is no fucking outcome, right? That we're just engaging communities for the sake of engaging and connecting, and whatever happens is great, and that we don't expect anything in return. That they don't expect anything or an outcome at the end of it, that we're just spending time together doing music, you know, rather than being on our devices, right? Or in my case, music, right? But there's theater processes, perhaps. There's dance processes, there's, right? And so if we focus on process more than product, then that's a way of disrupting capital markets poison, right? That can poison our own sense of spirit, right? Perhaps, but I guess I wouldn't want to go into a community and say we all got to suffer more because
I'm advocating. You know, I'm so reluctant to be a spokesman in any way because I'm sharing the very real daily results of the crucible that is my consciousness in relation to the world, And I don't want to tell anybody to go and suffer, but I know I have to learn how to suffer. And so that's all I can offer, is that that's the conclusion I am coming to, is that I have to learn better how to be able to withstand, because it's going to be, it's been bad, and it's going to get worse. Mm-hmm. And it's going to get a lot worse before it gets better. So what do I have to do? Well, I certainly don't want to go into a community. I don't want to go into your community and tell people to suffer.
You're welcome. You have to come. Now I want you to come. I'll be waiting for you there. Don't worry.
So
I'm your escort.
Okay.
It's clearly an urgent time in many, many different places. In the United Kingdom, they are facing all kinds of challenges around the Brexit, again from communities who are feeling disenfranchised, whether they are or not, they felt it. And I know in Australia, young potential cultural leaders are now talking about the need to be able to talk to people whose views are different from theirs. They can no longer simply ignore them. And I think if there's one thing that's going to come out of these incidents, both in Europe and in the United States of America, it will be that you can't afford simply to say, as one might have 30 years ago, oh, you don't like my art? Well, too bad, I'll just do it for the people who do like it. We're coming to a point where you've got to come to grips with the effects that can happen when you don't acknowledge what people are feeling at the time. It's an urgent time. It's a time of crisis, and I think I agree with Ayad that it could well be getting better before it gets worse. What are the first things that you do now? I'd love to hear from everybody. What's the first thing you do as a practitioner in this moment? Bree?
I think it's really important. I think I'm kind of like Martha. I really choose to be an artist embedded in the community. I think that that's a really important thing. You mentioned resilience. One of the things that we really are looking at as community organizers in communities that are frontline communities where they are suffering and are feeling the effects of the violent state most acutely, is how do we have that resilience in the midst of the resistance and all the other struggle that's going on? And art is a big part of that. So as an artist to come in and create, as you're talking process, I think there's product, I think there's process, I think there's also purpose. And I think that there's a purpose that art serves in facilitating spaces for healing, spaces for joy. As Black people, we have to carve out space for us to have joy in the midst of the constant mourning, because it can be something else every day. We have I'm down in North Carolina, I mean, we have the Michael Slager trial going on in Charleston, we have the Dylann Roof trial going on, the Charleston massacre, and then every other day there's a police killing. And so, I mean, this is part of a pattern of history that we have lived with, right? And I think that resilience through art, if you look especially at African American culture, is something that has always been there and is a strong element of how we practice resilience. And so I think that art is an essential function. We don't call it art, by the way, and I agree. I think that art and artists, these are labels that we put on ourselves as we have to commodify what we do. But really, I consider myself a creative. It is being. It is showing up in a space, and it is being in a certain way.
Mm-hmm. Ibtihaj, what's your first instinct at this moment? What's the most important thing for you to do in the current climate?
I think for me, it's all, most importantly, it's to stay true to who I am. I think that there's this pressure that's being placed on, you know, underserved communities, minority communities to kind of, you know, in some way change to make themselves, you know, seem more American or to, like, you know, aspire to whiteness in a sense. And I want us to continue to believe in, like, the diverse America that I know, you know, and for us to be more accepting of one another, and for especially, in particular for our youth, to be comfortable with who they are and not have to change and morph into someone else's ideal, into, like, who they should be, and when I, you know, speak to these youth, these different youth groups and different communities, in particularly within the Muslim community, I try to encourage them to, you know, not allow other people to dictate their journey for them. I think that so often we kind of force, you know, cultural norms, societal norms on our youth. And I think it's important for them to, you know, believe in themselves and believe in their journey. And I think that that's always been important to me.
Martha, with talks of walls and deportation, there must be incredible fear amongst the communities that you work with in Los Angeles. What's the first most important? What's the most urgent thing for you at the moment?
Yeah. Can you come back to me?
Yeah.
No, no, actually, you know, I think it's really important for myself as a artivista. I think it's really important for me to always keep one leg in the community. They are my moral compass. And the next thing I think is to continue to create, right? To not let the sense of, at times it hits me, hopelessness break down and inside of me where I feel like I can't do anything about it. That will never happen. Music keeps me going, it always has. And the next thing I think that's really important is that we need to network to build community and alliances across other communities, right? So I think it's really important for us to work in a local sense, and I'm not talking about supersizing or growing some big organization. I'm talking about being strong in the local capacities and then being able to bridge across other communities and struggle. And so the immigrant communities and the kinds of deportations that they're facing and all of this scare is very much related to black youth and, you know, and state-sanctioned violence, right? It's very much related to that, as it is related to other hate crimes across the country. And if we begin to connect more, I think we're going to realize that it's all about power, right? Wielding and isolating powers and dividing up resources. And if we haven't learned anything from past social movements, we have to do our research on those social movements and what happened, how they were extinguished, mm-hmm. right? How aspects of them were extinguished, how they were appropriated, right? How even rebellion can be marketed, right? Mm-hmm. So we need to be very careful of those things, be very aware of the market, build at a local level, so that, and be strong in that sense so that you're able to move across and network with others in struggle, and so that we keep it going and we're always one step ahead of whatever it is that it's trying to overcome and dissipate, you know.
And finally, Ayad, as somebody who uses words so magnificently, it's such a great skill, it's so beautiful.
Thanks.
What's the most urgent thing?
I don't know. I mean, I think for me, I just want to becoming a better writer, which to me means that my craft and my imagination can encompass wider and wider contradictions, and that the terrifying beauty and, you know, enraging despair and extraordinary rapture that we are capable of, and the terrific violence that may be ahead, is all part of a vision that I'm able to share with those who come to see the work I do, that we can find some kind of space. I don't know if that changes anything or doesn't change anything. It's what set my course when I was 15 and had a high school teacher who changed my life. She made me fall in love with literature, and I've never wanted to do anything else since then. So I'm just doing the same thing, but I'm trying to do it in a way that is awake to the world.
The message is, hold true to yourself, be aware of the context, flow, change, it's going to be necessary, but never lose that thing within, and that's what we know artists have profoundly amongst us in our world. Ladies and gentlemen, please thank our remarkable panel.
Thank you very much. Please, can we have another round of applause for these fantastic individuals and advocates and warriors and speakers? Thank you. Kepler speakers not only helped us in bringing Bree Newsom to this stage, they are also sponsoring our opening night party. So please proceed down the hallway to our opening night party. Have a lovely evening. Stay up too late. Do everything. First night APAP, whatever that is, and enjoy yourself. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you.